waitresses.
Julie, can you walk in? I don't think it's a room.
My.
Yeah.
Okay, wait, hold on, What's the fastest way? Fastest way.
Bridge?
You get, Georgetown Pike.
Yeah, but that's it.
No, we should have gone to Old Dominion. Yeah.
Where does he live?
Jamie Sam!
No, Jamie.
Where does he live?
Tam, just look at me.
Top side, whatever you want.
Tam?
The arrow
is pointing
right.
This is sick.
You can see the back of my shirt.
Camera? Where's your honors, Cam?
What?
Honors. It's a neat idea. Are we being recorded too?
Yes.
Turn off for a second.
I know. 20 years are gonna love it.
Camera.
Camera.
Come to see your graduation.
I
To our teachers, what can we say? You challenged us, sometimes against our wills, to reach beyond and discover ourselves and the world around us. We have not only faced grueling tests in the classrooms of Langley, but this year, our senior year, the school itself became a demolition disaster area. In late October, the renovation began. Now first, mammoth orange vehicles with metal teeth took our precious parking spaces. Then, one day we arrived at school to find all the ceiling panels had disappeared and the lifelines of the school were exposed. It was downhill from there. The front of the school became a giant mudslide enclosed by a metal fence, which was perpetually knocked down until they cemented it into the grass. The schoolyard was transformed into a trailer park, and the halls became an obstacle course composed of ladders, dangling wires, and workmen. Now, even though we won't be around to enjoy the fruits of this renovation, our class endured the dust and nails admirably. We can take pride in knowing that we have laid a solid foundation for a better Langley. I am confident that we, the class of 89, are leaving an excellent example for all future Saxons to follow. While the school is under renovation, making the old new, our class is in a state of transition. A new life is beginning. And yes, our education never ends. But don't panic, because we already know how to survive. As a matter of fact, according to a book I recently read, we learn the basic rules for life in kindergarten and spend the rest of our lives trying to follow them. Let me leave you with these simple rules that have withstood the test of time. Share everything. Play fair. Don't hit people. Put things back where you found them. Clean up your own mess. Don't take things that aren't yours. Say you're sorry when you hurt somebody. Wash your hands before you eat. Flush. Warm cookies and cold milk are good for you. Live a balanced life. Live some and learn some and think some and draw and paint and sing and dance and play and work every day some. Take a nap every afternoon. And finally, when you go out to the world, watch out for traffic. Hold hands, and most importantly, stick together. Enjoy the ceremony.
Our graduation today is a source of mixed emotions for many, and We must remember that our mothers and our fathers, our brothers and our sisters are all growing just as we grow. They are all changing just as we change. And as proud of us as they are right now, they are equally saddened at the prospect of our departure. May we also remember the hard work which got us here, and yet at the same time, may we not mistake what we have accomplished for who we are inside. And may we take pride in our success today, and yet at the same time, may we always remember our God who has made all of our fortunes possible. My fellow graduates, this is our minute. This is our 60 seconds with which to run. And with God's help, I hope we can fill it. Yet not necessarily with distance run, but perhaps with silent thought, simply sitting still. Thank you.
And to say how deeply honored I feel to have been asked by you to speak today. I would guess that there are quite a few of you out there waiting to see how I'm going to play my audience. Whether or not I'll be low in the knees, smile all the way off, do a cha-cha-cha, a fast time step, or a hand job. A former Langley student, in calling the other day to congratulate me on this honor of being asked to speak, suggested I open my statements by commenting on Langley with the following quote from Jane Austen: "One does not love a place less for having suffered in it." But this day is not for antics or jokes, or in Shakespeare's Hamlet terms, just words, words, words. This day is for confirming achievements, crystallizing memories, and for pausing thoughtfully to consider what it means to be a graduate. It's a day for close scrutiny of yourself and of that world you are about to enter, and for consideration of how you will relate to and find your way in that world. In reaching to articulate in a meaningful way my part in helping to evoke such examination, images of my own graduation day surfaced. It's spring, 1942, a little over 6 months after Pearl Harbor. In the section reserved for seniors in the big auditorium, there are here and there empty seats, each covered with wide red, white, and blue ribbon. As names are called to receive diplomas, a figure standing next to the podium steps forward occasionally to place a tiny American flag on a board set up for that purpose. Each flag represents a senior who, having turned 18, has enlisted or been called for active duty. How different the world was on that June day, and yet how much the same. There were problems of great magnitude. Old patterns were changing dramatically. Ahead was tremendous uncertainty. Ahead also was tremendous challenge and opportunity. History has chronicled that world of my graduation day. Let's take a look at the world of yours. Although there remain problems, there always are problems. Seldom in history have so many forces been converging on so many fronts to open new discoveries and effect positive change. Consider the new Hubble Space Telescope, soon to be launched, will generate new understanding, new theories of the cosmos never dreamed of. It will enable us to view galaxies 14 billion light years away with 10 times the clarity of ground observation. Through use of front object spectrographs, wide field planetary cameras, and other incredibly sophisticated capabilities, we will be able to keenly define the atmospheric structure of planets within our galaxies and perhaps define new galaxies. On our own planet, in just the last 10 years, scientists in deep diving submarines such as the Alvin and Pisces have discovered on the ocean floor active volcanoes that can sustain life without the sun's energy in temperatures close to 700 degrees Fahrenheit. In seawater, heated to this temperature as it circulates deep down in cracks and lava and underlying rock, have been found, along with constantly forming mineral deposits, whole biological communities. Just imagine life with liquid water and volcanic activity. What if our new capabilities for defining atmospheric structures in explorations of the heavens reveals the same synergism of lava, water, and life in new galaxies? It boggles the mind to think of it. Structural realignments are breaking down old barriers and shaping new designs that are affecting our lives in interesting ways. Many families, probably many in this audience today, are already learning to cope with this new global world of instant communication and interdependent economies. When offices operate in such diverse geographical locations as Tokyo, Cairo, and New York, whose clock defines 9 to 5? Learning to operate effectively on a daily basis across the world's time zones and keep equilibrium in our lives offers an exciting new challenge. In what language or language will you be conducting your business in? Just yesterday, in walking through a Merrill Lynch office in Annapolis, Maryland, I overheard bits of 3 different international phone conversations, each one being conducted in a different language. Closely aligned with the above structural changes are attitudinal changes. At the international level, the old political architecture is being chipped at and dissembled on several fronts. As we have observed the awesome events in Russia and China, the elections in Leningrad, the construction and agitation for democracy of a goddess of liberty in Tiananmen Square, we are exhilarated. Though uncertain about how the new political dynamics will play out on different fronts, we recognize that America could be slipping into a new role of elder statesman in a world dominated by democracy. Attitudinal changes also are occurring at home. There is a growing awareness that we must recapture values and mores that bring substance and grace to life. We must restore the harmony of we are by bringing the I am and the it is, the things of this world, into meaningful sync. We must nourish the bonding of family and community. A recent article in Sports Illustrated, in defining reasons why Bartlett Jamadi, former Yale literature professor and Yale president, had accepted the position of new baseball commissioner, pointed out that one notion above all directs Jamadi's thoughts, and that is his concern that in matters of courtesy and consideration, America and its people are deteriorating. In practically every essay in Jamadi's collection, A Free and Ordered Space, he argues that civility has to do with decency and mutual respect, and finally, with a free and ordered common life or civilization. In his address to incoming freshmen at Yale in 1982, he attacked what he termed a new arrogance of the individual, an antisocial narcissism, a grubby, selfish drift that robs Americans of our sense of civility. And that if we do not preserve a sense of shared community, the whole institution will wither and die. He took the job of baseball commissioner mainly, he said, to fight against privatization of leisure and restore civility and public pleasure in public places. And this world of your graduation day offers incredible new challenges, tremendous opportunities, heartening changes in attitudes. Within the next decade, the next century, think of it, the 21st century, it will realign in ways we are just beginning to envision. And it is in those years that you will go to college, enter the workforce, raise your families, be the designers and shapers, new vision makers, and articulators of that world, not just in the grand aspects of it, but in the day-to-day living out of it. And as I think on your world, dizzy with promise, newly energized with fresh challenges and hope, I long to say what graduation speakers always long to say. Kids, things are just wonderful out there. That world's just waiting for you. Just walk across the threshold. God's in his heaven, all's right with the world. But as these echoes run through my mind, I'm reminded of a poem by the contemporary poet, Russian poet Yevtushenko, called Lies. Telling lies to the young is wrong. Proving to them that lies are true is wrong. Telling them that God's in his heaven and all's right with the world is wrong. The young know what you mean, the younger people. Tell them the difficulties can't be counted, and let them see not only what will be, but see with clarity these present times. Say obstacles exist they must encounter. Sorrow happens, hardship happens, the hell with it. Who never knew the price of happiness will not be happy. Forgive no error you recognize in the young. It will repeat itself, increase. And afterwards, the young will not forgive what you forgave. And I know that I must add in another component to what I have to say to you today. A component in the form of wishes. Wishes that may at first startle you. For you see that wonderful world of discovery, opportunity, and hope is waiting for you. It desperately needs your courage, your creativity, your energy, the freshness of you, the new solutions you will bring to old problems. You can make a difference, but that world is a rough taskmaster. It will fold its arms and say, show me that you've got what it takes. Prove yourself, not only in professional and work skills, but in integrity, compassion, and self-discipline. The difficulties can't be counted in that world. Sorrow happens, hardships happen in that world, and who never knew the price of happiness will not be happy. And so my wishes for you. I wish you discontent. Not the passive discontent that leaves you empty and rootless, but an active discontent that makes you reject cheap solutions, ineffectual actions, disengagement, both in yourself and others. I wish you intolerance of rudeness and lack of civility in yourself and others, intolerance of moral bankruptcy, intolerance of those who never do, but through unjust criticisms and distortions, destroy the doers. I wish you frustration, not the kind that jangles the nerves and erodes the spirit, but the kind that forces you beyond your seeming limitations, gnaws at you to move stone walls, generate new goals, to back up when stymied and go forth in new directions. I wish you stress, not the negative kind that comes from guilt, boredom, or the overcrowding of your life with trivial pursuit, but the healthy kind that comes from determination to pursue a task, extend yourself beyond yourself to achieve worthy purpose. I wish for you to forgive no error in yourself, for it will repeat itself, increase, and eventually, you will not forgive in yourself what you forgave. The curtain is about to go up, my dear wonderful young people, on the biggest drama of your life. You will be the main scriptwriter, the primary actor, and in the end, the harshest critic. Play it well.
Well, here we are, sitting together one last time. Only now we aren't chasing sweat beads off our forehead on the gym bleachers, nor sharing a big bite fruit cup in the cafeteria, nor lounging sleepily in the back of the auditorium. No, today we sit adorned in our ceremonial attire, surrounded by our family and friends under the historic architecture of Constitution Hall, and a richly ornate aura of celebration. I want to put aside my bustling anticipation, my subtle anxiety, and look at you all one last time. I want to remember the halls during break, cafeteria lines, courtyard during the spring with the smell of a long-forgotten barbecue and the sound of a volleyball game. The brown brick, the attendance office, the career center, but most of all, I want to remember you, because I'm going to miss seeing each one of you. Across from me at lunch, browsing through your locker, or catching a quick nap in class. I'm going to remember you for what you were and what you did, whether you played the trumpet, sang in the choir, participated in student government, or played football. I have learned to treat my memories like old clothes, to throw some away, to keep some in the closet, and to wear others even more proudly because I know why I like them. Well, today, I'm wearing each and every memory with dignity. Each memory of dry tears, friendships, long talks, and short days. Who could have told us when we started at Langley 4 years ago what it would be like? Apprehensive freshmen in the fall of 1985, we could have hardly seen the future as it really was. Who could have told us about double burrito days and freeze-dyed grease sticks? Who could have told us about Mr. Comey's iridescent fuchsia socks? Who could have told us about the savory smell of roof tar and an entanglement of pipes and wires for a ceiling? Who could have told us about college applications and sadistic aptitude torture, preferably known as the SAT? Who could have told us about AP, PSSC, AB, GT, BC? I still don't know what they mean. Who could have told us how many times we'd be feeling ill again so that we would have to come in late with a note? Who could have told us that we'd be sitting here in 4 years after approximately 4,000 hours in class, forgotten friendships, and a high school diploma? Well, no one could. But what we did know was that we were intimidated, scared, and unsure of ourselves. But just the same, we know that old fear and anxiety will come again in days ahead, at college, in jobs, in new places. But next time it will be easier, and we'll do better because we've been prepared. And it was not without cost to our parents, our teachers, and to ourselves. So today is not so much about us, it's about those of you who prepared us. It's about the late nights when our parents helped us type an application, or made us a cup of coffee so that we might avoid the osmosis method of learning, that is, facing the book. It's about the advice and guidance received from our counselors during the application process. It's about the encouragement and support of the administration. It's about Mrs. Lentz's clinic passes. But most importantly, it's about the understanding, inspiration, caring, listening, sharing, and love that we have received. It's about the wind beneath our wings. Next year, each of us will meet new people, see new places, and find new friends. Oh sure, there's fiber optics, Amtrak, TWA, but somehow it's just not the same. We will branch out from here, each of us going somewhere different, but always having the memories of our time here together. Who knows, maybe 10 years from now, we'll meet somewhere in an airport, have a cup of coffee, and take the time to remember again. As Thornton Wilder said, time goes by so fast that we hardly have time to look at ourselves or each other. Amid the confusion and haste, we haven't had the time to stop and look at ourselves. Langley has taught us more than just how to set up an algebraic function or dissect a pig. It has taught us about feelings, friendships, and most importantly, about ourselves. Only 45 months, 2 weeks, 1 day, and 8 hours ago, we started the Langley. In that time, Russia has democratized, Marcos fell, the stock market crashed, the Challenger exploded, China has revolted, we elected a new president, Chernobyl had a nuclear meltdown, the Redskins won the Super Bowl, and Bill Murray made 3 movies. But more importantly, we grew up and learned something about ourselves. If this much happened in 4 years, imagine what will happen 5, 10 years from now. We face social and economic dilemmas which rattled those many generations before us. AIDS, the greenhouse effect, the nuclear arms race, smog, trade deficits, drug trafficking, and unbalanced budgets. The tasks are monumental, the challenges are great, but we can overcome them. Succeeding generations are counting on us. As Robert Kennedy put it, our answer is the world's hope. It is to rely on you. It cannot be moved by those who cling to a present which is already dying. It demands the qualities of you. Not a time of life, but a state of mind. A temper of the will. A quality of the imagination. A predominance of courage over timidity. Even our determination and vigor will meet with failure. It will be hard to have the courage to choose the excitement of danger or the illusion of security. But more important than success is the determination to try. As Teddy Roosevelt once said, far better it is to dare mighty things, to win glorious triumphs, even though checkered by failure, than to take rank with those poor spirits who neither enjoy much nor suffer much, because they live in the gray twilight that knows not victory nor defeat. Let us go forth from here, resolve to dare mighty things. Congratulations and good luck to each and every one of you.
This time, if you follow your programs, we will have the presentation of awards. First, I want to congratulate all the parents and grandparents who are here today. You have been the support and strength behind the success of these students, and it's so nice to have you here with us. A special welcome to our grandparents, who I consider to be really the backbone of America. Welcome to Constitution Hall today. At this time, we will begin the awards presentation by recognizing the seniors who have achieved a 4.0 cumulative average or better on a 4.0 scale. I would ask you to please hold your applause until I have read the names of those who are to be recognized. If you would stand when I call your name. Henry O. Jennifer Lee Blackwell. Suzanne Emily Schweders. Anthony E. Nygren. Please stand. Christian Andre Berger. Jennifer Lynn Savage. Sarah Sidman. Brandis Judith Keynes. Suanna Carrie Selby. Stacy H. O'Brien, Tim Samuel Gerton, Peggy Vivian Shea, Josephine C. Yamada, Emily Christine McNeil, Stephen A. Fisher, Carrie Carrie Adams Hendon. Yeah. presented by Mrs. Julie Corlogus, one of our dearest parents and a member at large of the Fairfax County School Board. We have appreciated Mrs. Corlogus's support and leadership throughout the past years. Unfortunately, she finishes her term on the school board very shortly. Let's give her a round of applause for the job she has done. We have three children. Okay, this time, the Langley High School Faculty Award is presented to a senior who has demonstrated leadership, enthusiasm for school, participation in school activities, a high degree of sensitivity to others, and academic success. This year, the faculty has selected an excellent leader and a great person, Suzanne Emily Schreuder.
Presently is in what they refer to as the Bridge Program,
These are for head injuries, head trauma injuries. Catherine Parsons, who graduated last year, came through this program. And James Brady, President Reagan's press secretary, is also in this program. Today, it's a pleasure and a privilege to recognize this individual as the most inspirational senior. I call Ms. Nancy Brown and Ms. Sharon Madison to make the presentation. Will Scott Turner Newcomb please come forward?
Thank you. really dumb, Tammy.
Barney, look at your mother.
Yeah, because they don't give the prices till like 5.
Yeah.
That's
what?
Why? Why do you
think
what?
Do they have breakfast?
Really? When are
they? I mean, like a contest?
They have all kinds of
prizes. Oh, good things. Good
things, yeah. They're
giving
away a car.
Savings bonds.
A car? What kind?
Maybe a
JK Chevrolet.
Ticket to Miami to Florida.
Yeah, they have tickets. Do I get
to
apply
today? When you wake up and tell me what you want.
What do you get?
Your graduation present.
You're spoiling
so
that
Emma,
dog.
I
she likes it.
You have breakfast, Dana.
Tonight?
Yeah.
I do.
Yeah, I think they give breakfast.
So it's late.
Irma?
Yeah.
Yeah.
5 for 6.
Oh.
Everybody's
so tired.
Oh, my God. Here. I wouldn't even call these. These dogs are so spoiled.
Yeah. Oh, no, they want to sit with us.
Okay.
Come here.
Okay. Why are you going to get better food?
Here, we can sit on the floor.
Ah, you did not have to
Irma's mom made that.
I'm gonna sit away.
Table? What's his pin? What's his pin up and down?
Down the
Whoa!
Let's go.
Game, I'm telling you.
Yeah. Like it, huh?
Oh, man. There you go. Big winners.
Is that on for first roll?
One roll only.
One roll back.
Not me.
Started. Hope it rolls good.
Nine.
We're trapped.
Oh, great. All right.
Quite creative, so I think that you would use your ability someplace in architecture or design in an area like that. I see you more there than any place else, and you'll be able to do big things. The way you use your space is that you can work with big spaces, and you're equally good with details as well as that big picture, seeing the big picture right away. So that's how I see you, and you're quite independent.
That's an understatement.
Well, it's that personal pronoun I that tells me that, even though you print. Because most choose the Roman I, you know, this one.
Mm-hmm. And it takes so much work.
Yeah, and you could be very good with details where you like it and have a good, because that's your carefulness. But then you also have and good details from back to the pictures.
Hey, Don, can I see your picture?
Yeah, that is scary. Because that's so true.
And I think that you also, I see one anyway that is a high eye that shows your creative imagination too, which I'm sure you don't have to have if you're in any of these fields. But you are excellent.
So how did you do in international business? Like in the international business, which
because if you did international business or law, you have to cram a lot of details, a lot of facts and figures and details. But then she's also got the advantage of being able to see what's important, the big picture, which is a good combination,
big and small.
Yeah, and you do like yourself, like the responsibility. You don't like it. You don't like
it.
So you like it, right?
She loves it. She loves it.
Are you going to college?
No, I have to be.
Yeah.
So that's good. So are you interested in something like international
business?
Yeah. I think you put some originality into it. I think that's a very good thing. You know. whatever you did, that originality and some space.
Good job.
Yeah. I'm that even shows you some. I just finished writing a book. It was dumb. I just happened to notice
it. Did I write enough
eyes? Way out. In fact, you're going to have to make sure that your energy doesn't go too far out. Well, you are steady here anyway, but this thumb goes way out, so that means you do like, you're very versatile, and you're, you know, original, and people who are very inflexible, and the thumb doesn't go out at all.
Go.
I think you probably also have a musical thumb. You probably like sports as well as sports and to see a tremendous energy coming out of
Super Mario.
Why are you? Were you sort of a female child?
No, sports not that bad. Well,
you are very physical, but you like to combine the physical and the mental, which is great. Where you feel strongly enough, I think you really persevere.
That's Marianne.
And
Tammy Burton.
What? Have you ever thought of working with an animal or
never
or young or young kids? Somebody, because I see they're quite protective towards the weak.
Oh, wow.
You know, like for the ignorant, towards the underdog.
Okay.
The interest in sports medicine.
Yeah,
that would be very good. Interesting combination of you being being still
it is
very much involved with your family and close friends.
Yeah.
As much as you're interested in new things, but they are very important.
What the new things?
No, the old things too. I mean, family and friends are very, very important. Family and friends relationships, because you're using the margin very much still in the past for right now. I mean, because you're young and your future. That represents the future. And here you're a little hesitant, but then later on you're coming out. Try all these different things, and your right slant shows that you're very interested in new things and in the future. So it's sort of like a combination of the two. And your values are still are between traditional and wanting to do your own thing. You're right, sort of in the middle.
What kind of field would I be? I mean, you said studying animals or children.
Well, you could work.
What kind of business things?
Well, I see you working with people, definitely.
Like a counselor
would be good, because you got the right plan, you got a fairly large right. But I think you would know people who are good at knowing people and working with people. I think. And you're also logical, but you're. I think you're intuitive to a degree.
You gotta be intuitive.
Meaning that you could, like if you were working with people, that you could figure out their emotions and being able to deal with them.
I'm going to go to the next one.
the wall.
Man, the sunrise, that baby's gonna come fast.
Jeff and Mauricio. Rogers.
They snuck out of their house as well. So, ouch! Ouch!
Pretty exciting, eh?
Wait, Mary, did you get pearl earrings or a pearl necklace?
Earrings. Guess what one Overy said to the other Overy? Look, young man. Trying to move furniture around down here and there's some org.
You've screwed up the joke.
Shut up! Trying to move furniture around here and there's some nut down there trying to push an organ in.
Guess I ate a lot tonight.
I ate half that turkey sandwich. I don't know. It was ugh. Maybe I should put my hands back in.
Hi, Tammy. I'm tired. I'm going to go night-night.
I want to go night-night. Where's my hands? You guys, we are leaving for the beach tomorrow. That is awesome.
Yeah.
You guys have no money.
Who are you
and
riding with
for
tomorrow?
All that beer and all that food. What?
Who are you riding with tomorrow?
I guess Tammy. Tammy,
you
know
who's driving it. Who's riding with Pam? What's wrong?
I'm Tammy running. Oh. Hey, Marianne, I'll push you.
Ouch. Hurts my butt. Guys, what day is today?
June 16th.
What day is it today?
We're now high school graduates, and that means we can apply for PTC Career Institute.
Yeah, and Truck Driving Institute of America.
And Diesel Institute of America.
And the Washington School Secretary.
Yeah, WS. Dumb squirrel is still sitting there.
All the way. Get that wrinkle out. You got a wrinkle on that side.
Fuck you.
Get that up. Now pull your shorts up. Now put your sleeves up. Shorts all the way up.
They are.
down there so I can take your picture. Oh my God, your talent too. Totally from hell.
Okay, okay, got it. Yeah.
You guys have to wave into the camera. Hey guys. Good morning. You're gonna be on TV tonight. We've just graduated, guys. Yeah.
My God, Joe.
Joe who?
Still recording. Domino's Pizza.
Joe who?
Oh, Joe.
Jeff. I understand how people do this. It hurts my eyeballs. Here, okay, listen. Documentary. Graduation is kind of over. Because we just got home from the all-night party. It's like 6
Mary,
in the morning.
Get your stuff out.
No, I don't want to get my stuff out. I'll get it tomorrow. And Beach Week will be starting. Today's Friday. Tomorrow. So, I don't know.
Damn. I lost my All right.
Excuse me. What the hell is this focusing?
Tammy lost key.
The key?
Was I just driving the car? I think I had it.
Yeah,
I
mean, that's funny. She just loses the key.